St. Blaise's day, the stork you'll spy, and if you don't, a year of snow draws nigh. In this instance, the popular Spanish saying aligns quite well with ornithological science. Indeed, storks are nearly always found in the Iberian Peninsula in the month of February. We've just witnessed them flying near snow-capped mountain ranges. Even as Spanish lands still crackle under frost, and often under snow, despite the saying, the storks are already here. However, in natural sciences, there are no exact rules. Some storks spend the entire winter in Spain, others arrive before St. Blaise's Day, and some come later. The life of the stork itself is a true saga. The stork is one of the most striking birds in the Iberian fauna. For this reason, we dedicate an entire episode to it, to the white stork, and also to its somber and shy relative, the black stork. When storks perch on the belfries of our villages on St. Blaise's Day, on the old towers, as almost everyone knows, they come from Africa. Specifically, the western population of European storks, among which Spanish storks are included, come from an area that I will draw for you on this map that I have on my desk. It encompasses much of Senegal, Niger, and the marshes of Chad, all naturally south of the Sahara. And here, in this perfectly humid tropical zone, where nutrition abounds for them, these storks spend the autumn and winter months perfectly. Midwinter, they begin to fly northwards to settle in the Maghreb, and to enter through the Strait of Gibraltar into the Iberian Peninsula, our population of storks, which, however, leaves a large area empty, excluding eastern Andalusia, the Levant, Catalonia, the Pyrenees, the Basque Country, the Cantabrian region, and Galicia. The rest of the Iberian Peninsula, with the highest concentrations in Extremadura, still harbors our stork population, which is one of the most significant in Europe. Perhaps for this reason, this episode of Iberian Wildlife, which describes the customs of our storks, no less interesting and endearing because they are well known, is the one we have made with the greatest affection. It seems confirmed that the first to arrive are the males. After the long journey, within the month of January at the beginning of February, the male storks alight in the places where they nested the previous year. The old experienced storks return exactly to the same place where they have repeatedly bred. The young storks, the precocious ones, colonize areas that may be far from where they hatched. When the male and female meet, a ritualized nuptial and greeting ceremony takes place. They emit guttural calls known in Spanish as crotarar. The arrival of the storks is often noisy. Some find their nesting site already occupied. Others have to expel a precocious intruder who has mistaken the site. But in the end, each stork goes where it needs to. As the month of February gives way to March, when the stoic storks have endured the cold, the rain, and the February gales, the repair and reconstruction of the nest begins.
Thank you.
There are tenants who occupy the old stork nests and live associated with them. Perhaps the most characteristic are the sparrows. They have slept on the cold winter nights in the nooks and crannies of the stork's large nest, and some of them are even preparing to build their small nests in the great house of the great migratory birds. Apart from sparrows, birds of higher standing, such as the common kestrels and the lesser kestrels, also take refuge in the neighborhood of the protective stork. And of course, the ubiquitous spotless starlings that nest everywhere in Spanish villages are not lacking either. Something stirs in the atmosphere at the end of February and the beginning of March. Something prompts the sparrow to enter the hole in the house where it will raise its young. The duration of daylight is increasing, what scientists call the photoperiod. And this seems to be the signal that sets in motion both migration and reproductive mechanisms. Old nests need repairing or building anew. And the swallow, an early riser as well, arrives in Spain, recuperating from the long journey across all of Africa. Starlings engage in their courtship displays. They are birds adapted to rural environments and modern human civilization, some even breeding in the middle of winter. After resting from their long journey, the storks begin to transport materials for their nests. Both males and females cooperate in building the new home or repairing the ancestral nest. There are new nests, barely composed of sticks and straw placed on a ledge. There are old nests, enormous, and storks consider pieces of plastic, old rags, and discarded human garments in the fields as attractive trophies. Repairing the old structure or preparing the new one takes storks from 8 to 15 days, although they continue to bring materials throughout the breeding season. It's not uncommon for what one stork laboriously carries to their nest, including shiny pieces of clothing, colorful plastics, old rags, and papers, to be snatched by thieving storks who find it more convenient to take what the naive ones have brought than to gather new materials, as we will soon see. Thank you. But not all is work for the storks during the initial nesting phase. The ritualized courtship display is almost constant. The male and female spend a lot of time together in the nest. They engage in what, perhaps being anthropocentric, we might dare to call the expression of love in the world of storks. Affection between storks also a hygienic purpose, let's say. Carefully, the male preens, delices, and deparasitizes the female. Then mating occurs, repeated and frequent during a short period of time. After the weddings, after the passionate love affair, the storks, naturally, have to eat. At that time, the neighboring kestrel, hovering above the tractor to catch the creatures unearthed from the hard earth by the plow, is invited by its friends, the storks, who have also learned in the fields of Extremadura and other parts of Spain, to follow modern agricultural machinery to benefit from its work. It's sowing season. The earth is opened by the tractor's plow, and in the soil lies the treasure trove of insect larvae, worms, and beetles that have spent the winter protected by the earth's protective layer. And the storks, perfectly adaptable, ubiquitous, with a wide-ranging diet, at this time gain a great deal of energy by following the tractors in their plowing. In some villages in Extremadura, such as El Gordo, the stork population is so rich that it would give a false impression. We might believe that there are still many storks in Spain. But the truth is, as Professor Bernis has kindly communicated to us even before publishing his latest observation, the decline in the population of Spanish storks has been catastrophic. Since his last census in 1957, to the one he has just conducted and is still carrying out, there has been a decrease of at least 40% in the stork population. He estimates in global figures that we must have between 8,000 and 9,000 breeding pairs. In the first census he conducted in 1948, there was also a decline, until the second one in 1957, but not as marked as the last one. It seems that storks began to disappear earlier in Andalusia. There are many factors that are suggested to explain the decline in the stork population, which in some European countries has been dramatic. Among others, the alteration of the countryside, especially as a result of modern agricultural systems. Ecological changes introduced by irrigation systems, dams, pesticide pollution, massive urbanization of the fields. The truth is that, in the last days of March or the first days of April, the storks deposit their four eggs in the nests. Carefully, they settle onto their clutch, which requires a long month of incubation, 33 to 34 days. Although some storks lay three eggs and others lay five, four is the norm. They are large, finely granulated, and white. During the incubation of the eggs, the male and female work closely together. While one of the consorts provides warmth to the treasure from which the little storklings will hatch, the other is out fishing and eating or resting, as if encouraging the incubating consort. It is known, however, that the female always incubates during the night, and it seems that she dedicates more time than the male to this task. During this time, the kestrel is also busy keeping a close watch over its mate's clutch. Eggs numbering five, with a reddish color, can perfectly coincide with those of their neighbor, the stork. Sparrows are also very busy with their courtship, with their new nests. And of course, the cat, that ubiquitous rooftop cat, is never absent, seemingly a mysterious witness to the lives of birds in our urban centers, which still have the fortune of hosting urban avifauna. Occasionally, the stork turns the eggs. This delicate maneuver aims to ensure even heating. It appears that the eggs are laid with a 48-hour interval. Consequently, the hatching of the little ones will also have this difference. Here lies the origin of that small bird that is always present in all nests, the one that hatches last and often doesn't complete its development and upbringing successfully. The month of April unfolds, and the starlings joyfully welcome the arrival of the first warmth with their daily baths. And the stork, seemingly startled by the motor of our camera, allows us to witness the great miracle. One of the eggs is already cracked. The little storklet has broken through the shell that protected it with the diamond of its beak. Within a few hours, hatching will take place. The chick, immediately after hatching, looks completely helpless. Its down feathers still wet. defenseless against the heat of the sun or the coolness of the atmosphere. Watched closely by its mother, who will soon cover it to protect it as soon as we leave. With genuine regret, we steal a few minutes from Mama Stork so that you can see and witness the birth of a baby stork. Meanwhile, the neighboring kestrels, now grown up and wrapped in their dense grayish down, patiently await the arrival of their parents, who will come to feed them with mice, birds, insects, and lizards. The little storks grow very quickly, remaining in the nest for 2 months. And as the days pass, their appearance changes. Their initially short beaks and petite legs will stretch out. They will change their down feathers twice, and very soon the shafts of the large feathers will appear. Punctually, with her feet stained by the mud from the nearby marsh, Mama Stork arrives. Another female is protecting the little ones under her wings. It is essential to maintain thermoregulation at all costs. In the first days of May, it can be very cold or excessively hot. Without the protection of the mother's wings and body, the chicks could perish. They have a peculiar way of begging for food. They peck at the red, scarlet, maternal beak. And the stork tries to regurgitate some food she has caught or hunted in the countryside. In the area where we filmed our storks, in the fields of Extremadura, there was a nearby marsh. It was the main source of food for the stork population. Every morning, they flew off to the waters, where at that time of year, carp began to abound. In a graceful landing, which looks more like a parachute jump, the stork descends towards the place where other companions are already fishing. Competing with the gray herons, unparalleled in the harpooning of freshwater fish, the storks explore the depths of the marsh, already low in the flow of its waters, to catch, with great diligence and precision, the carps, which they will later bring back to the nests in their gullets. But this, from fishing, to feeding the young, to emancipation and the migratory journey, will be the subject of the next episode.